Blackstone Audio presents Love for Sale, Pop Music in America by David Hajdu. This book is read by George Newbern. In memory of my sister, Barbara Ann, and for my sister in spirit, Elisa Solomon. Introduction. Of the countless terms for categories of music, from classical and blues to the secret password language of microgenres like doomcore and neurofunk, the least useful phrase I know is popular music. It provides no information about the music itself, no suggestion of how it sounds or what sort of mood it might conjure, no indication of the traditions it grows from or defies, and no hint of whether it could be good for dancing, for solitary listening, or for anything else. All the term tells you about the music is the fact, or the assertion, that it's popular, that a lot of people seem to like it for some reason. The words popular music are like sociological taxonomy, a way of defining a body of creative work as a measure of the group of people to whom it appeals. What good is that if you're not a sociologist? I have always found the very notion of the popular off-putting, in part because I have never fully outgrown my early conception of popularity as something restricted to the girls I was afraid to talk to in the sixth grade. I can't help but think of anyone or anything popular as part of a world I don't belong in. This line of thinking is rooted, I admit, in a vain feeling of exceptionalism. They all think they know what's cool, but I know better, and that makes me even cooler, which I suspect is anything but an exceptional way to feel. It seems likely to me that a great many people, particularly Americans, being citizens of a society in which rugged individuals and rebels and outlaws and misfits have always been glorified, think of themselves as outliers or exceptions in one way or another. Nobody wants to feel like everybody or just anybody, and because we know we are defined in others' eyes by our preferences in music, movies, TV shows, and other cultural products, most of us tend not to talk about popular music as our favorite music, no matter how deeply it has run through our lives. I like to think of myself as a jazz fan who grew up on rock and roll. But the truth is not so simple. The jazz repertoire was built largely, though not solely, through the adaptation of popular standards, songs originally created by tunesmiths such as George Gershwin and Irving Berlin for the musical theater, with the explicit goal of making hits. Gershwin's I Got Rhythm, written with the lyricist Ira Gershwin in 1930 for the musical Girl Crazy, is the source material for more than a dozen other tunes in and out of jazz. Duke Ellington's Cottontail, Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie's Anthropology, Thelonious Monk's Rhythm A-Ning, Sonny Rollins's Olio, among others, not to mention the Flintstones theme song. Pop always fed jazz and continues to do so today, with venturesome jazz artists such as Brad Meldow, Bill Frisell, and The Bad Plus playing repertoires that mingle original works, compositions from the jazz canon, and rock tunes by the likes of Oasis, Soundgarden, Black Sabbath, Nirvana, and Rush. For a period around the middle of the 20th century, when big band swing was a musical craze, jazz and popular music were essentially the same thing. Popular music, or pop in the term's most popular form, although the two expressions are not always perfectly interchangeable, has run very deeply in my life, as it has run through the lives of innumerable Americans over the course of more than 100 years, since the mass audience for American popular culture first took form in the late 19th century. This audiobook is an effort to come to terms with that history and its meaning. What are we talking about when we talk about pop? And what bearing has the music had on American life? Does popular music matter, really? And why is it so relentlessly romantic and sunny? Or am I wrong to think of pop that way? Among the ironies of popular music is that it is a phenomenon of vast scale and intimate effect, a product of mass culture that reaches millions of people or more at a time and works for each person in a personal way. We could look, as an example, at the tune that qualifies by some measures as the most successful popular song of all time, Yesterday, composed by Paul McCartney and first released on a Beatles single in 1965. It would be broadcast in its many renditions more than 7 million times before the end of the 20th century. The other side of the original release was Act Naturally, a country pop novelty that had been a hit for the Nashville star Buck Owens, warbled on the Beatles record by Ringo Starr. In at least one early advertisement for the record, Act Naturally was promoted as the A-side. Yesterday made the Guinness Book of World Records as the most recorded song.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.